Hello. I thought you'd want to be here. I am Hazelberry Hawthorn. And I'm a woodland fairy and I live just here in these woods. Just outside the Pixie Moorland realm. Now, I suppose you're wondering why I've summoned you all here. Well, I have a very good reason. I have a very important story to tell you all. And the thing with stories is that they have to be told, or in the very least read, for if they are not, they're sadly lost forever. And I happen to be this particular story's teller, here to tell a story of a story often told. Although the names and faces may change to suit, the tale is of common substance. Whether you believe the tale or not is up to you. I shall not be your judge. Now, let us begin this story at its glorious beginning. Before I do, just one thing I want you to know about the elementals, or elves, or pixies, as I've often heard them referred to in books like these. But for the benefit of our story, we shall call them fairies, for that is what they are. I can hear you sniggering. Now, I said you may not believe, although it is advisable that you do. Now, fairies are wondrous, glorious, magical beings who, on leaving this earth, dwell and live in the tween times, such as dusk or dawn, or the midnight hour, and sometimes on very, very rare occasions, midday. Now, I think I've said enough for us to continue, but before I do, I'm going to tell you a ditty that we always say in our clan. They lived in clans on Pilton Moor until the time they vanished. They lit the lines of the Fairline Valley to dance through brook and cranny. It takes belief for them to stay, for their demise will follow if you do not. Yet to believe you would plead madness, for the fairy realm is now forgot. Forgot, left to wander upon a fairy flea. Some say the reason for their swift depart was to find a fairy soul, as the tale of one who lost her clan was very often told. Let me begin this tale at its glorious beginning. Thimble Cotton Flute was a moor fairy, a beautiful, colourful, talented young fairy who was the daughter of the well-respected Lord and Lady Flute and lived in the magical valley of Piltonia, which sat somewhere between the second moon in Saturn and the rising sun of the southwest. It was as far away as you could possibly imagine and just around the corner from that. Now, the fairies of this wondrous lush valley were probably just as you would imagine a fairy to be. They were smaller than a pixie, but bigger than a wisp, with small button noses. And their ears were very pointed, and the older they got, the bigger the point would become, signifying wisdom and knowledge. They could levitate wherever they chose to go, and their clothes were made from brightly coloured fine linens and always worn with great pride. Fairies enjoyed nothing more than excelling in their subject of choice, and Thimble was no exception. She was, by all accounts, a great talent indeed, and her parents could not be prouder of their daughter's extraordinary abilities in fairy magic. She had been trained at the great fairy school of arts and far exceeded her tutor's expectations. She could levitate without having to blink, vanish in four different languages. But her greatest achievement to date were her abilities in levitational travel, which were quite astonishing. She was totally extraordinary, completely marvellous, extremely talented, breathtaking beyond belief, beautiful without having to try, and utterly, utterly fed up. It's a very strange disposition to be in for somebody so extraordinarily talented and beautiful, I hear you say. And yes, you'd be right. So let's delve in further. Now, the fair queen of this fair valley, and I have to say it was very fair. I mean, they had wild mushrooms that grew in 13 different shades of red. And the crystal waters were the purest in any other land. And the flowers, they were so beautiful, they'd been grown by the queen's very own gardener. Anyway, where was I? Yes, the queen, Queen Lilybell the Red, had often noticed Thimble with her beauty and extraordinary talent and was so impressed with the little fairy's abilities for one so young. And she was, after all, only 153. It's very young indeed for a fairy. That she had appointed her nephew and head knave, Tilano Toil the Second, to marry her. Such a privilege and honour for a fairy with no royal blood in her veins to be invited into the royal family, that any fairy should and would be the happiest they could be at such a prospect. And all in sundry across the valley were rejoicing with delight and merriment at such a wedding. That, of course, was everybody except Thimble. And had Tilano Toil not been the nephew of the queen herself, she would have spat on the ground and turned all the flowers in the valley black in protest. Oh dear. Tilano Toil, or Till, as we shall call him, was in her eyes simply the most repulsive, rude, lazy, vulgar, and unfairy-like fairy that had ever lived. Oh dear. And how her hand could have been offered to such a creature exceeded even Thimble's ability of thought. She remembered one time when she had caught him fishing in the Pink Lakes for the rare majestic fire dragons. This had particularly angered Thimble, as not only were fire dragons one of her favourite creatures, but they were so gentle and beautiful. No one should ever be chasing or harming them. You see, fire dragons were beautiful, shy, peaceful creatures who were thought to have descended from the persecuted dragons of this earthly realm, that you have no doubt read about, and I have certainly written about in books like these. And although, like their somewhat larger ancestors, they were able to breathe fire, they were of no threat to any living soul, and by all accounts were truly wondrous creatures. And if you were to spend long enough by their waters and were quiet enough, they would start to sing and dance and play through hoops of fire and clouds of white smoke, and their music would mesmerise all that heard. Thimble, Cotton Flute, with all her heart and magic, loved them. Which meant Till was on pretty rocky ground as she watched him run around with an open jar trying to catch one. Thimble could watch no more and jumped out in front of him. "What wicked thoughts have jumped into your head today, Till? Ooh, were these poor creatures not tormented enough once upon a time, a long time ago, but not so long ago that we should forget?" exclaimed Thimble in her loudest voice, which echoed across the valley. "If you think for 1 minute you're clever, Till, I'm afraid you're very much mistaken. In fact, I could teach you a few things about vanishing spells that last for weeks." And with that, she pulled out her faithful wand twig. "Amazing," was the only thing that Till was able to say. "Oof. You're a clever little thing, even if I say so myself," he said, dribbling. "I was never the best student at spell making," he continued, "and would love a fairy like you, funny clothes and all, to teach me." "Teach you?" gasped Thimble, looking down at her clothes, which she happened to quite like.
What a repulsive thought. Now away with you before I turn you into a putrid toad, she continued, Till roared with laughter and could all but stare in delight at the angry little fairy. He was in such awe of Thimble that in that moment, had she actually turned him into a putrid brown toad, he probably quite liked it. Especially if it meant Thimble had done it. This only infuriated Thimble more, who decided that in order to remove herself from his unwanted attention as quickly as possible, she would vanish back home in Trollican. Trollican was a traditional form of travel used by the trolls in the flatlands, usually in thick forest, but I suppose Thimble had felt that it was an appropriate time to use it. Bother, huffed Till, as he slowly watched Thimble fade out of sight. He knew he had no chance of following her and went back to the royal kitchens to find honey biscuits and sulk. Bless him. Ah! Those are the calling birds. But I'm afraid that I must go. So I know you'll want to come back and hear more, so I shall return. And we shall continue with our story about Thimble and what she's going to do about this awful knave Till. I must make haste. But take care of yourselves. And remember, don't stop believing, especially in you.